So that's the program. If there's any questions, I can take it.
John, very interesting presentation. Thank you. My question is on the gray water or black water systems for, you know, new buildings larger than 250,000 square feet.
Mm-hmm.
So there must be, like you said, some kind of maintenance of the systems in there. So what type, do you have any requirements for operators or maintenance technicians? Is that written in any of the permits or
That's a great question. So for four of the alternate water sources, gray water, rainwater, stormwater, and the foundation drainage, the person operating the system has to prove competency. It's a very loose term. They have to prove competency. They basically have to provide the San Francisco Department of Public Health proof of their background, proof that they know how to operate one of these systems. And they have to sign an affidavit saying that they do know how to, A, that the training that they said they got is true, and B, they know how to operate the system and understand the maintenance has to be completed and all of those things. The only system where we have a more descriptive requirement is for black water systems. So black water systems right now, you have to have a grade 2 wastewater treatment operator to operate your system. It will be interesting to see, there's some districts, some large redevelopment districts coming forward in the city that have to comply with the ordinance. And if you need to do on-site water reuse at 12 buildings, 13 buildings, I don't think you're going to do 12 individual gray water systems. You probably do one district scale black water. So we'll be curious to see who they get to operate that thing. So that'd be great too. So will private operating firms start to pop up in San Francisco? Will our wastewater treatment operators see an opportunity to start their own businesses? We'll have to see.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So for
So the question was, what was the developer's response to the mandatory program? Because the voluntary program was voluntary, so
right.
The developers did it. Well, it was politically a pretty smart move. So the voluntary program, the city families developed the ordinance, we wrote the language, we wrote the program, and pretty much handed it to a supervisor, and one of the supervisors loved it and said, oh, this is a voluntary program, I'm going to go for it. The difference was with the mandatory program, a supervisor came to us and said, I'm going to introduce this, I'm going to make it mandatory. And it depends, I mean, it's politics, but the supervisor that happened to introduce it is a very developer-friendly supervisor. So he was sort of their ally, right? In a lot of ways, he's fought for developers. There was a moratorium going forward that they were going to try to stop building in San Francisco for a lot of different reasons. And this one supervisor is sort of the go-to for developers. So when he was the one that said, and he's backed them so many times, and he was the one that said, you're going to put these things in, they weren't going to sort of, for lack of a better term, bite the hand that feeds them. So it was really smart politically. If it would have been a different supervisor, the supervisor that always blocks development, for example, maybe a totally different ballgame sort of politics. But so he introduced it. We had three working groups with developers that came in, and they got to comment on the language of the ordinance. So the supervisor tweaked some things with it. But they did not show up in full force at the Board of Supervisors meeting, the actual meeting. There was maybe two developers that came in, said something, so it was passed through the board unanimously, which never happens in the city. It was all 13 supervisors voted 13-0 that this was going to become mandatory. So that was sort of that politics game, you know, but they know it's a cost. It can certainly add cost to your project.
It's really reality that just got to get water, and that's just the source. Because I work for SFPC, I previously worked for LA County, mm-hmm. and the two desert plants in the sanitation districts, they have more people trying to get water than they can produce.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's one of the strategies that water utilities are going to have to implement. I mean, I think personally, DPR would be sort of the way to go. You know, it's going to be a big, but I think you integrate these small systems in within the larger systems a lot of utilities are paying, and you can start to meet, you know, a lot of demands. Yeah.
You mentioned, at least in San Francisco, that now that it's mandatory that you have grants, so it sounds like you made the barriers to entry pretty minimal in the city. When you take this program and try to apply it in different municipalities that may not have that kind of a friendly situation, what kind of barriers have you seen that would stop them, especially if it's only a suggested, not mandatory type of thing?
The biggest stopping is just the lack of a regulatory framework, you know, and a usually a local health department or a local building department that just doesn't want this to be done, right? So for 50 years, the plumbing inspector, who's the head plumbing inspector, said, no, the pipes come down and go to the street. You don't take the wastewater and put it into a tank in the basement. So a developer will go to them and try to get a system permitted. One of the voluntary developments will say, I want to do the greenest possible thing. And usually the local building inspector or the health department in charge will say, no, we just don't want to even consider this. So that's usually the biggest barrier. Where we have a little bit more success, and again, we're not pushing other cities to do this or counties to do this, to do it voluntarily. Well, we've seen more success with other projects. Every so often, probably once a week or twice a week, we'll get a call from a health department from wherever that's at least considering it, at least sitting down at the table and saying, well, what if we let this happen? And then they talk to us, and sometimes they come and take a tour of our building, or we connect them with the health department people. I always feel like I'm good to speak to water utilities. The health department person who has questions should speak to our lead regulator, the SFDPH lead health department person. They speak the same language, you know. Same with the plumbing inspectors. If they're a head plumbing inspector, should call our head plumbing inspector. And if they're willing to hear it, usually they're willing to allow it. But some people, they just say no, and that's usually a brick wall that people hit.
So with the grants that you guys have come up, where is that grant money coming from, and can you compare it? Are there any state grant programs similar, or have you heard any other municipalities being as progressive as you guys on the grant program?
So our grant program comes from our operating budget. So it's just a line item in our operating budget that our commission approved. And I haven't heard of any state grants for local on-site systems, you know, with the small systems that we're talking about here. I've heard of a lot of great state grants, you know, for larger projects, significantly bigger than $500,000. Grants for $8 million, $10 million, things of that nature. Portland is pretty progressive in terms of installing these systems. What they've done is, do you guys know what capacity charges are? So if a building wants to hook up in San Francisco, they pay a water capacity charge and a wastewater capacity charge. And it's based on the demand that that building is placing on the water system. So it depends in terms of how big your building is. So this building is going to have a bigger water and wastewater capacity charge than this building because it's placing greater demand on the pipe that's feeding it, and the sewer pipe that's feeding it. What's Portland done, and they're big charges, I mean, in the millions of dollars, not $2 or $3 million. What Portland did was they said, well, if you're going to do on-site water reuse here, then you're sending way less water to the sewer and taking way less water from your water lines. So instead of your capacity charge being $3 million for this building, it'll be $600,000. So that's what they've done. They haven't given a grant, but they've said reduced capacity charge. Yeah, exactly. So that's the only other place I know that's really, and we're starting to look at that as well. Because it kind of makes sense. If you're placing less demand on the water system, then you shouldn't be charged quite the same capacity charge. Yeah. I mean, we looked at it, we've analyzed how many future developments this is going to apply to. We use what's called the Planning Pipeline Report, San Francisco Planning Pipeline Report. In the next 7 years, there are 24 buildings that have to mandatorily do it. 24 new buildings, I mean, it depends on how our capacity charge structure is set up, but it's not a huge revenue loss. We're seeing much bigger revenue losses simply because of how effective our drought conservation has been. Our revenues are significantly down because of that.